Thanks for having me here today. My name is Matilda Raynes and I'm a Master's by Research student at the University of South Australia. And I also work for Keep South Australia Beautiful, where we work in schools to engage children and teachers about waste management, although I won't be talking about that today. So my research project is entitled Changing the World for Good, Mapping the Long-Term Impacts of Adult Environmental Education and Sustainability Programs in South Australia. So before I begin, I would like to acknowledge that this conference is being held on the traditional lands of the Gubbi Gubbi peoples, and I would also like to acknowledge the Kaurna people as the traditional lands on which I work and live in Adelaide, and recognise their continuing connection to land, water and community. I'd like to pay my respect to Elders past, present and emerging, and extend that respect to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people here today. So the research is justified by the threats posed by global current socio-ecological crises and also the need for environmental and sustainability education or ESC programs to support regenerative communities. Now this is a broad term encapsulating all different programs, including citizen science. There is also a need to understand the effectiveness of these programs as sustained outcomes, and systemic impacts are underrepresented in the literature because they're quite ambiguous and hard to measure. So there were two main research questions. The first, looking at the long-term impacts of adult environmental education programs in South Australia and beyond. And then the second one examined the barriers and enablers to creating and sustaining these sort of changes from these programs, as experienced by the participants and facilitators. So the design of the research was originally a comparative case study. However, after facing many different challenges in terms of COVID and recruitment, it was changed to a single case study. So the research draws from an exploratory mixed methods research approach, with these multiple methods being used for data triangulation. Now, the key case study of the research is a program called Living Smart, which is administered by Green Adelaide. The program is a community-oriented program which seeks to support individuals and communities to become regenerative and increase their sustainability efforts. The program looks at about 8 to 10 different topics with a weekly workshop. It is unique in the way that it really emphasises community connection and collaboration, and helps to connect people with things that they're passionate about. So it connects people with all different sorts of programs, including many citizen science-based programs, such as hooded plover monitoring, OSMAP, which looks at microplastics, and bringing back the butterflies, just to name a few. So there are two other programs that are associated with the research, but not key case studies. The first one is called Australian Red Cross Climate Ready Communities, looking to make change at a community level in terms of climate action. And then the second one is Living Lightly Locally, Smarter and Stronger Through Citizen Science. Now, this program is actually allied to my research, and so the evaluation and findings from my research will help inform the evaluation and development of this project, as it is just coming out of a pilot phase and looking to extend further into the community. So my research is defined by its focus on stories. So narrative inquiry is a key aspect of this. It allows us to capture rich accounts of program experience and unexpected program outcomes and impact. So there are four phases to the research. The first was phase one, which was expert interviews, where we unpacked the program logic model. Secondly, we had participant and facilitator interviews, and phase three was an online survey. And both of these techniques, we were really focusing on collecting stories of change. Phase four looks like follow-up focus groups to map the ripple effects of the programs into the wider community. This hasn't happened yet, we're still in the recruitment process for this. So just to touch on the analytical approach, thematic analysis was used, which looked like multiple coding cycles of the interview transcripts, as well as the survey data, and then categorizing these codes and drawing out themes. And then this technique was also paired with narrative analysis. So this looked like analyzing the data against a story structure, developing story cards from each interview, and then cross-checking these stories against thematic codes. Now I'm just going to share some of the preliminary findings. Just a disclaimer, these are preliminary, so they may be subject to change. As the data analysis process is quite iterative, we're going back and forth between the different methods, so they will have fluctuations and changes as the research progresses. So this is an example of a story of change. So a story of change card was developed for each participant that was interviewed. So at the beginning of this program, the participant was wanting to find purpose, give back to their local community, and to reconnect with nature. However, they lacked knowledge and awareness of environmental challenges. So during the program, they gained knowledge and improved their awareness across different environmental and sustainability topics. They established lasting friendships and built their confidence. Towards the end of the program, and then carrying on post-program, they changed their behaviours, shared learnings with others, and co-founded a local living Smarties group. They've gone on to participate in local community actions, campaigning, civic engagement, and volunteering. And they've also done a lot in the citizen science space, being engaged in the Hooded Plovers monitoring program and other sort of conservation programs. So on the significance of this, they said that the changes change their life, they're part of their everyday life and their everyday thinking, they're incredibly important to them and they love that they're thinking this way. Now I wish I could show you all their stories because they're pretty impactful, but that's just an example. It's by no means a representation of all the stories, it's just a great one to highlight as it kind of shows the different domains of change that can happen post-program. So across all the stories, we had 13 interviews, and the highest recorded change from these interviews was behaviour change. Behaviour change referred to many different things. Gardening, consumption around waste and food were highly recorded, as well as transport use. On top of that, increased knowledge and awareness, that social and community connection, and engagement, decision-making, and household change were also highly recorded. Now, in terms of barriers, the most recorded barrier across the stories was financial barriers. These look like people wanting to purchase electric vehicles or install solar, things like that. But then also COVID was a big barrier for engaging in that community aspect, and especially that citizen science aspect of things, especially when things went to online and it was a bit harder for accessibility. Now, on the flip side of that, the enablers that helped to catalyze change and also sustain change were in that social realm as well. So a supportive social network was by far the most highly recorded enabler for people, as well as inspiration from others and hearing other people's stories were talked about a lot in the interviews. Now, mapping is used in the research in a few different ways. It's used to capture wider impacts and highlight broader community linkages and system elements. It's great because it explores change across different timescales, systems, and social networks. And something about this research that I didn't mention is the Living Smart program has been running for quite some time now. So some of these interviewees participated in the program as long as like 2016. So it's quite a broad range. I wish I could go through this map, but it would be a whole nother presentation. But just quickly, the blue dots are the participants, and then all the other coloured dots are different stakeholders. So the yellow are organisations, the green are community groups, the orange are councils, and so forth. And the lines represent the connections between the participants, and all the other stakeholders are then the connections between the stakeholders. And this is, if I could go through this map completely, the different connections are labelled, so they will show if a participant made this connection post-program, during the program, or if it's kind of a ripple effect of the program. And we'll also be using a different technique for mapping in the focus groups. So, just briefly from the survey, it's still open, so these are very preliminary findings. Out of 24 responses so far, behaviour change again was the most recorded change, and then increased knowledge and awareness was another change. And then in terms of the barriers experience, this was an interesting one. This was actually a multiple choice question instead of an open-ended question like in the interviews. So we did get quite a different response of the lack of corporate regulations, which was an answer people could choose. And then time was also another big barrier. And then in terms of the top enablers, gaining knowledge and awareness was the key enabler, but then also people were great enablers. This was in the context of meeting like-minded people or inspiration from others and shared learning. So just based on those preliminary findings, we have some preliminary recommendations. A key one is for evaluation of any program to be built in from the beginning of a program, especially for these long-term evaluation, because it is really hard to go back in retrospect and build in these evaluations in terms of ethics, and then also just recruitment and getting people on board to talk about their experience. And then prepare for recruitment challenges, because there will be some no matter what you do. The nature of research is never gonna go how you expect it to go. And then we found that those social connection elements were great enablers for people to make and sustain changes. So incorporating that into program design could be very valuable. And then also came up a lot in some of the data was that post-program support. People seem to be really engaged during the program, but then kind of as it dropped off and there was no support, that kind of just fizzled out their changes as well. So incorporating that could be a really useful part of program design. So just to summarise, research aims to explore the long-term outcomes of the programs. Oh, sorry, that didn't look like that on my slide. Programs and enablers of change. It also aims to explore program impact and the reach of these programs in South Australia, and to offer direction and recommendations for future program research and evaluation. I'd just like to thank all the people that helped get this project on the ground running, the support, and also to my wonderful supervisory team. And then just on a final note, we've heard about so many interesting, brilliant programs this week, and I'd like to invite you all to think about how maybe stories could play a part in either sharing all the amazing outcomes or providing inspiration for people. So thank you for listening.
Thank you, Matilda. That is some really robust and impactful research that you're doing. Yes. And it sounds like it's got some inbuilt rewards for you as well.
For sure. It's an amazing project. I'm very happy to be on board with it. Yeah.
Very exciting. I'm sure there's some questions.
Excellent work, Matilda. Just procedural question. Can you trip it back one slide so we can get your email thing?
Of course.
Yeah.
Come on. Oh, the red? Yeah. I don't think I'm pressing it hard enough.
Thank you.
Thank you, Matilda. That was beautiful research. I was really happy to see the results from like behavioral change of participants. Mm-hmm. I wonder, what was the average age of people, of the adults participating in this? And did you explore their motivations in joining the program? And did you see if their motivations were met, like during these, you know, like story cards that you developed?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the age range, the highest recorded was between that sort of 35 to 60 age group, and it was predominantly women. Out of the 11 people interviewed, 10 of them were women, and one male. So yeah, that demographic is quite apparent in the research as well. And then in terms of their motivations, they were quite widespread. A lot of them just wanted to learn more. That's what came up a lot. And then a lot of them also just kind of wanted a lot of them were already interested in the space and doing their own thing, but they'd experienced sort of burnout, or you know, they've been doing this for years and they just like felt like maybe what they were doing wasn't worthwhile, or that's kind of what demotivated them. So a lot of them were just looking for that kind of spark of like, you know, this is actually helping, this is what we're doing and we're making a difference, which was really impactful. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
That was really interesting. Thank you. I have two questions. One is short, so okay. I'll start with that. You mentioned with the survey something about the like a lack of corporate regulation.
Yeah.
So what is that?
Yes. So we had that question as a multiple choice question, and then we had a comments box for people to expand. Some of them did, some of them didn't, but the ones that did, there was a lot of talk about waste and the amount of plastic packaging there is and the lack of corporate regulations and supermart regulations around that, as waste is quite a big topic in Living Smart. So it's about, you know, when you go to the shops and everything is covered in plastic and you can't really escape it unless you, you know, shop at a local farmer's market. And then that kind of brings up the more like financial barriers as well, that can be more expensive. So that's what was recorded in those comments. Yeah.
Okay, cool. And sorry.
That's all right.
The map that you had.
Yes.
I realise it's probably quite complicated, but it looks very interesting.
Yeah, I wish I could do another presentation on it.
I was especially curious about the social networks that like you have, like I think it was a grey spot.
Yeah, like, the little black spot. So yeah. This is also a map in progress. Everything's in progress at the moment. We weren't quite sure how to record that. So one of them, the one where almost every blue dot is connected, that is we asked people if they shared their experience or their learnings with others, and that was kind of how we represented that. So there was a lot, almost every single person said that they'd either like shared their learnings with others or they'd like given out information to others. And then the other black spot is them like directly not involved with the program at all, doing some sort of social event, maybe with their friends. They did a mini event where they made everyone beeswax wraps and they got to participate in that, things like that, when it wasn't really program related, but still building that social network and building like the learnings from the program into the wider community.
Yeah, fascinating. Thank you.
You're welcome.
We really like your project. I was really interested in the story cards and the impact you had on behaviour in adult education, and it made me wonder about whether we could repeat this study. Do you think it would be useful to capture the experiences of teachers working with citizen science? Because I think even the comments that you showed in that one example was such a beautiful way that we could use to almost advertise to other teachers, like, look at the wonderful things that happen. Have you thought about doing that, and do you think it could work?
For sure, no, that's such a great point. So we haven't actually done anything in schools, but the program that this is allied to, the Living Lightly Locally, like I would love to be able to get that in schools in some way and then do that. I think the story cards are a really great way of showing the impact in a different way, because a lot of people and a lot of citizen science projects, they show impact in a way that might not relate to everyone. And so this qualitative way that is very accessible, you don't need any sort of science knowledge at all to be able to understand it. It's a great way of, yeah, just getting that story out there. And there's a lot of research around the power of stories and how stories can be like these catalysts for change, and that emotional aspect, which might not come up in quant sort of representations of outcomes. So yeah, that's an amazing point. I can share the research on the story cards. It's founded in Dr. Jester and someone Davies, sorry, I don't know. but they've done a lot of research on it and it's been involved in many programs.
Great, thank you.
You're welcome.
sorry, I have a question still about these story cards. Yeah. Do the participants participate in the process of the story cards? Do you send the story back to them so they can check if it's authentic?
Yeah, so we kind of captured it in the interviews by kind of prefacing with the fact that we're collecting these stories of change and ask them to tell their story. And then, so in terms of that collaboration, we sent the transcripts, so that was the full transcript, back to the participants and asked them if they wanted to make any changes, if it all sounded good, and then the data came from that. I would like to go back to the participants with these finalised story cards just to ensure that it is an accurate representation. We're still working through that, yeah, but yeah, it's a great idea, thank you.
Do we have anyone else curious? Of course you do.
Yeah, that's a big question, isn't it? Everyone asks me that, and I have so many interests. I'm really interested in policy, and that sort of community engagement at a wider scale, but I also am super interested in not only community-based education, but also the schools-based education, which I do for my work. So the answer is I want to do lots of things. I'm not quite sure what yet, but my supervisor's project, the Allied Project, Living Lightly Locally, that we're in talks with partnerships to extend that for another 3 years and make it more widespread in South Australia. So I'm a research assistant on that, and I'm hoping to collaborate with that and really work on that and just get this sort of education out. Thank you.
Hi. Matilda, you've got time. You can do all of those things. You've got plenty of time. Great work. Have a rest.
Thank you very much.
Your work is just the poster for citizen science, really. You know, why we all should get involved, because these are the outcomes.
And a lot of them are unexpected. Oh. You wouldn't know until you ask the story, exactly. Which it's all about. Yeah. Thank you. Well,
what a great note to end on. We're just going to wait. I think more afternoon tea's ready in about 5 or 10 minutes, if not already. I can't see. But just take the time to ease yourself into afternoon tea.